Welcome back, everyone. We are here in the AWS reInvent press area for our coverage of AWS reInvent, 4 days of wall-to-wall cover. I'm John Furrier, host of theCUBE. Mukesh is here, GM and director of Amazon Q for Business. Great to see you.
Good to meet
you. Thanks for coming back on theCUBE. Appreciate it. Obviously, yesterday was the big keynote reveal of more Q for Business. Yeah. We had a little scoop with the lip around this product. Q for Developer, everyone's seen that. It's been quite the buzz, and listen, the progress, the numbers on Q for Developer. So you're seeing that same value proposition going to business, which I love because the trend towards democratizing the non-technical programmer user is really kind of here, right? It's coming, it's now.
Yes.
And I think Q for Business to me highlights the progression of the developer market as they go closer to the hardware and do more harder things. Like Swami pointed out on stage, the coding's not going away. It's being augmented by Q for Developer, but the productivity gains that the non-technical users are getting with Q for Business is to me, one of these really game-changing moments, because that's going to change the entire labor equation. This is a big part of Q. So take me through the announcements here at reInvent real quick, and then I want to get into some of the implications of what this means for an organization.
Yeah, thanks, John. Yeah, so we are super excited about the things that Matt talked about yesterday. Like, you know, the ability to combine what Q in QuickSight does with what Q Business does. Like, imagine sort of a business, you know, intelligence person, BI person, being able to not only generate reports about their business for the last 6 months, but also extract all the information from all the meetings they've had, you know, all the information sitting in, you know, in their documents, in Outlook, and all of that, bringing it all together. That's just compelling. So that was a big, you know, announcement. The second one that Matt talked about was this ability to take actions in, like, you know, our users in Q Business, they can, within Q Business, they can, with natural language, say, I want to, you know, create a ticket, like, for the specific support cases, make those things happen right there within the chat window. That's super compelling as well. What then all bringing it together is sort of the workflows.
Yeah.
Like, there are these workflows that people have in sitting in SOPs, sitting in PDF files, kind of bringing them, all of them together, being able to say, well, you know, Q Business, just make these sort of, you know, flow, just sort of give me what the workflow looks like and then execute those.
Yeah.
That's compelling as well.
You mentioned QuickSight, I thought was good. And also Brainbox AI is a company that's being featured. I think I interviewed him at that company many times. Great team there. But I think one of the things that you see with the agent discussion that Swami was laying out, he loved his example of finding free food at the event, and he had this whole agent set of tasks.
Yeah.
Like, that's so clever, because it's like, we have all the party, like, people should write an app for that, actually. But he's highlighting the reasoning. And what I like about the Q for Business and some of the things you said about QuickSight is that the data storytelling, it's data storytelling, basically. You can
Absolutely.
Use querying through whatever natural language or any interface to the user, not technical.
Yeah.
And like, have it do stuff, like give me a PowerPoint presentation or make sense of this. So there's reasoning is a big part of this. Talk about the this is not just, you know, some sort of clever chatbot or like some trivial thing.
Absolutely not. Like, what's really happening behind the scene is, you know, we are using these models to, you know, sort of go through all these, you know, structured data that exists in your data lakes, data stores, and all of these places. And these models are trained to actually make sense of, you know, give insights to the users, right? And it's not just the data scientists, data engineers, but other folks as well. Through the Q Business interface, they can basically say, well, you know, get that insight from Q and QuickSight and combine it, all of this together. So it's much more than just a chatbot at this point of time.
Yeah, it's foundational, I think, for the agents too. Let's get into some of the specifics around benefits to customers. Because I think, I won't say they're going to be skeptical, they're going to be like, okay, where do I use this? So take me through the process. I'm a customer, I'm a big enterprise, I got teams of people working on stuff, I always want to find stuff. So search, you see RAG is really popular these days. So I got a lot of data, I got unstructured data, I got structured data. What do I do? How do I deploy Q? Do I just hit the console? Do I have to roll out into the apps? How do I seamlessly integrate this into my workflows?
Yeah, so the really compelling thing is that your business admins, with only a few clicks, they can create an application. And once they have this application, they can sort of point it to the different various sources of data. It could be Microsoft Exchange, it could be Confluence, it could be, you know, any other data store you have.
Pull that S3 bucket and say, here's my S3 file.
Exactly. And then also what we do is we sort of preserving the security and privacy, we just pull that all into what we call the queue index. Matt talked about it yesterday, where once it's in the queue index, a user then can get insights from that data, but only the data that they have access to, and not any other sort of, you know, information that exists there. And once they have the insight, they can actually, you know, do task out of it, right? They can say, well, you know, I see all the information, now I want to take action based on that information. Like, if I was a support professional, you know, like, imagine the productivity gains I have in the sense of being able to look all through all the tens of thousands of support tickets that have already been sort of solved by my peers, and then being able to say, well, I know exactly how I solved this specific problem.
Do you see a use case progression where you can advise someone, okay, here's how I would start it. Do you pick a use case, you just roll it out everywhere? How does it get, because this is not just an application, it's a platform.
Yeah.
So you got to index things. So how do people implement it? What's your advice?
So I if I would have to tell, you know, like, and this is what we tell our customers is, you know, you have to pick a specific use case. You've got to make sure your data is cleansed. You've got to make sure you know exactly, you know, what problem you're trying to solve here. You know, for example, you could say, well, hey, you know, what I want to do is with this, I want to just keep content that my marketing folks need so that they can, you know, sort of create new content out of it. And then run those POCs, proof of concept, see if you're getting the compelling responses back. Are you see that you're able to create the content and it matches what your organization needs. So that's sort of how you got to start small, you got to see those gains, and once you do that, then you sort of, you know, kind of get bigger and solve other problems in the organization.
And the persona you guys are targeting is the business user? So, or I mean, I got to stand it up, I'm just kind of walking through, do I have to log onto the console, and then I provision it to the whole company, then this user's coming out of it?
Yeah.
So there
could be multiple use cases, right? I talked about the marketing use case where it's just the marketing teams who would do that.
Yeah.
However, like I could, you know, there are organizations which have set it up for all of their customers. Like, you know, for example, you know, Smartsheet, they pulled in all the information about how their employees onboard. All of that information is sitting in our index now. And what their employees do is they are big into Slack. So from within Slack, you know, once they have set up QBusiness, Slack becomes much more powerful. Well, they basically say, I know, like, hey, how do I get this information? What are the steps I need to do as I join this organization? And they get all the information that's sitting inside Slack in the Slack channel, but also in documents in other places coming from QIndex. So that's sort of compelling. It's just kind of bringing it all
together. So it creates an index of the onboarding manual, basically.
Exactly.
And then just allows for customization, personalization.
Exactly. Yeah. And sort of meeting the employees where they are in Slack, in Microsoft Teams, all the places that folks already work instead of having to go to yet another application.
So what are your goals for the business? You've got to look at the growth. What are some of your objectives as GM?
So we've got to focus on what our customers are asking for, John. Since we launched QBusiness last year, it was about, hey, you know, how do we get insights from this data?
Yeah.
Like, what do we do? Like, how do we sort of support more and more applications? Like today we support, you know, 45 plus applications where you can sort of get the data from.
Yeah.
Kind of keep on growing that is super important to us. And then agentic AI is sort of becoming really compelling. So we've got to make sure we're solving all those use cases.
I was talking to Swami about this on camera and off camera, but the off camera conversation was more of, it's such a hot area that you're in, you got such a great opportunity, but it's kind of you're vectoring into kind of in a pre-existing world of analytics and dashboards and then business intelligence. But you're also got the hardcore data geek side of it too, which is developing with agents. So you got all this new stuff kind of, so you got the confluence of kind of like the new personas that want to do this stuff over here. Then you got the old school analytics team. It's weird to say old school, but like analytics that have expectations. So you got, I want reports, I want dashboards, but then you got this new innovation. How do you look at that? Because you got to get the priorities.
Yeah.
You got to make sure you meet the customer where they are. I get that.
Exactly.
How do you look at that?
Yeah. So I mean, the to us, the you know, what we announced yesterday around, you know, QIndex, QBusiness coming together, customers of QIndex getting data from QBusiness and vice versa, that is a first step. We wanna sort of remove the boundaries of structured, unstructured. Like people don't. That's not how people think. That's not how, you know, users think about it. They just wanna get insight from all the data, you know, wherever it is, And that's sort of, we just want to keep on removing those boundaries.
I think your comment earlier about getting that data right, clean, and you said clean, but yeah. You get it nice and tight so it's accurate.
Exactly.
Access controls becomes a huge thing. Does CUBE Business learn access controls? Does it ingest? Is there magic behind that too?
So that's a great question, John. What we do is we basically preserve all the access control that were in the applications or those stores. We just sort of mirror them in the index itself. So exactly the thing that was sort of locked down before is locked down now. And we also keep on refreshing it. You could go and change the application. We make sure that those are sort of reflecting back in the index.
So maybe I'll get your tap your consulting brain here for a second to mentor our CUBE team. We have all our transcripts stored on S3. So just point CUBE at it and say, go to town, CUBE developer and CUBE business?
Yes, that'd be awesome. Like imagine like, you know, you could find all the sort of the transcripts of information, like all those sitting in CUBE index, it's searchable. You can kind of figure out where, you know, which were the ones, the interviews you were sort of excited about, the ones you liked, all of those at your fingertips.
I can see how many times Andy Jackson is undrifted heavy lifting and giddy up his favorite phrases. No, I mean, this is like we look at the content, it's all there. I mean, I can point it at it. It's on S3, it just sucks it all in.
Exactly, and you know, one of the I'm glad you brought this up, one of the capabilities, you know, sort of we are rolling out is the ability to sort of take those audio files as well and transcribe those, so you have even more compelling abilities, not just the text document.
Or you can link that transcript to the video.
Exactly.
Yeah, and roll up some clips. Sounds like something we should be working on.
Yeah, something, yeah.
But this is, all kidding aside, we'd actually do that, actually. But I'd love to ingest the data. But it brings up the simplicity. I'm trying to get to the point of that it sounds like there's a lot of dark arts of stuff going on. People get sometimes nervous. Okay, it sounds too good to be true. So how do they get going? So, okay, I ingest my data. Do I then expose an app to my team? What happens next?
So there are multiple ways. You can, CUBE Business comes with an application. You can expose that application. The other thing folks do is they create their own application and embed CUBE inside that application. So that's the second model where you already have an application, you can kind of use
like it. Slack.
Exactly, like you could basically say, well, you know, all my users are in Slack or Microsoft Teams, well, let's just bring them there. And there's sometimes folks have custom applications which they've already developed. You can sort of add CUBE to that as well.
So you can really make CUBE whatever you want it to be.
Absolutely.
That's pretty much, it's customizable.
It is absolutely customizable. The power comes from the index and the use of Gen AI technologies. And the front end can be anything that your organization wants it to be.
So congratulations, love this area. We'll probably do a lot more talk about this and get some customer stories come on the CUBE. But I have to ask you, you mentioned Smartsheet earlier. Are there any other customer examples you can point to that are innovating, leaning in with CUBE Business?
Absolutely. Asana is another one. You know, they provide productivity application. What they are doing is basically partnering with us so that when our common customer, they set up a CUBE index, and though that customer could tell Asana, hey, now you have access to all the data that from other applications or some parts of it. And then the Asana users basically imagine I'm sort of in Asana, I'm sort of looking at my project. I can pull in information saying, why is this project late? And all the information that sits in documents, in transcripts, all of that kind of shows up right there.
You know, you're going to appreciate this. When I talked with Deepak and Dilip when I was prior to this event, I know they're both product guys. So I said, hey, you know, how does CUBE for developer and CUBE change the role of product manager? Because if you think about the productivity gains, just on like the ideas of keeping everything together, because you got CUBE for Business and developers, so you could literally recast what a product manager does, accelerate the idea of moving the requirements in quicker, and then actually have the code assist start kicking in some coding. What's your reaction to that? Because this is an area I see as an example of many positions that productivity gains and how they do their job will change.
Absolutely, like it's like we see it ourselves in AWS, like in terms of how I do my job, in terms of how quickly I can access information. Absolutely, John, that's sort of, this is a transformative moment in terms of, you know, how you know, not just product managers, you know, developers, you know, operational people, all of those, like it's super compelling.
Yeah, I know you guys do a lot of internal, using Anthropic and a lot of the different models internally. Good to hear them tell that story yesterday, that internally even they're experimenting with all the different models. Any favorites on your end that you share, that you use, that you like?
Well, we, you know, like we will give customers the choice they want in terms of the abilities, and we choose the model based on, you know, the different use cases. So we are going to go where customers take us.
Hey, Mukesh, final word for the folks watching. What should they know about CUBE Business? Why should they care? And how do they just, what should they do with it? Give them some quick tutorial advice.
So like, you know, what I'll tell folks, your audience is like, you know, they should, you know, try it out, choose the data set, point it to the application, get going, you know, get some results out of it. They will love it.
All right, you will love it. You heard it here first on theCUBE. Okay, with more coverage here, do all the world coverage. I'm John Furrier, your host. Thanks for watching.